and to some pre-speech analysis by Shields and Brooks, Syndicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist David Brooks. David, there's been some punditry today which says this could very well be the toughest speech President Obama will ever have to make. Do you buy that?
I don't know about ever, but the pundits are amazingly sagacious most of the time. And you know, it's a tough speech because it's a straddled speech. Things are stable in Iraq, but not too stable. We're leaving Iraq, but we're not abandoning Iraq. We're paying attention close to home, the budget close to home, but don't worry, we're still fighting terror abroad. So he's got to do all that balancing, and Obama's a guy who loves, on one hand, on the other hand, formulations. And I suspect we'll hear a lot of that, but that makes it hard to write a speech because it's all a series of balances.
Difficult, you agree, Mark?
I guess I hadn't thought of it as being difficult, Jim. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's obviously a speech he's giving voluntarily.
Yeah, he didn't have to do it.
No, he did not have to do this, and it is at a time when the administration is looking for successes. This is a box you can check off, a promise made, a promise kept. But I think it's an awkward speech for the president because the president still believes and argued throughout his career and certainly in his presidential campaign that it was a preemptive war that was indefensible, that it was a national catastrophe, that the United States went to war against a country that had never threatened the United States, never attacked the United States, had no weapons of mass destruction, represented no threat to the United States, had nothing to do with 9/11, and it's damaged the United States. It's left the United States with less ability to put together a coalition elsewhere, with less respect in the world, with less capacity militarily, with a depleted military. So it's to say now the success that I'm
Never
associating
mind,
myself,
all of that.
Yeah, associating myself with. Yeah. I think in that sense it's awkward.
How is he going to deal with that? The fact that he was so opposed to this, and in some ways, some people would suggest it was his opposition to the war that helped him get elected in the first place.
Right, and he was opposed to the surge, which has got us to where we are today. And I think he's just going to ignore all that and focus on the future. I mean, Iraq is at the moment the seventh fastest growing economy on the earth. It is, according to the Economist magazine, the fourth most democratic nation on the earth. To have a democratic, prosperous Iraq in the Middle East would be a big deal. The problem is we're only halfway there, and I think the policy substance of the speech, which is worth paying attention to, is what do we do about next year? He has made a promise, which he reiterated over the weekend, that everybody will be out. All our troops will be out at the end of next year. And there is a lot of fierce opposition to that within the military and among some nonpartisan policy hands who say we've made some progress, a lot of progress over the past 2 years. All of that will be in jeopardy if we leave entirely in the next year because they still need us as the way the people in Bosnia needed a U.S. presence, the way the people in Korea needed a U.S. presence, and we've got to drag it out a little longer. And so that's really the policy decision that I think is key.
To none of the families of the 4,100 Americans or the 40,000 who've been wounded and sometimes crippled from this war, or the 100,000 more dead Iraqis, or the 2.5 million Iraqis who've been dislocated in their own country as a result of our invasion and occupation, or the 2 million Iraqis who fled. None of them was the case made, we're doing this because you're going to have the seventh fastest growing economy in the world. That had nothing, that was never, it was a bogus pretext war. And I think that makes it a real problem. And so but David's right in the sense the president has to deal now with the reality. I think the transition to Afghanistan, I don't see how anybody can look at Iraq and say it's a success. And straddle that then to go to Afghanistan is really, I think, very, very difficult.
How do you read the fact, the most recent polls, Mark, I wrote them down here, that majority of the American people, 54% or so, do think the war was a mistake to begin with. In other words, they agree with Barack Obama on the basic thing. I'm talking about mm-hmm. today. Mm-hmm. And 64% think it wasn't worth the 4,400 lives and the $750 billion it costs. Now, how to fit that into all of this?
Well, I think that's a complication. I mean, I think, you know, there is a policy decision that has to be made. Are we going to try this again? Is this going to be, is this a model
for
the future? I mean, a preemptive war. The latest I saw, Jim, was the CBS News poll completed August 24th. It said 72% of Americans said it was not worth the cost. The only Americans who believe it was worth the cost are Republicans. Independents by 2-1 say it wasn't. Democrats by 4-1 say it wasn't. So
how do you read that?
Well, I don't know if it was worth the cost. I don't think anybody knows, and anybody has the basis of knowing. I do know that for the first 4 or 5 years of the war, it was fought horribly. It created the deaths that Mark referred to, the destruction Mark referred to, but I do know the last 3 years have produced tremendous gains, both in terms of democracy, in terms of 90% reduction of violence, in terms of economy and a country that seems to be fragilely heading in the right direction. And I'm sorry, but the fact that Iraq, at the crossroads of the Arab world, if it became a democratic, healthy nation, that would be a huge deal. And that's where we are now. That's the decision we face now.
Forget how we got
there. Well, we'll have the debate 30 years from now about the relative costs. Right now, it was not worth it. Right now, if you measure the cost of the deaths, both here and in Iraq, it was not worth it. But if 30 years from now, we look to Iraq as a healthy nation, a democratic nation, which spawned some ripples, and I'm not sure if that'll happen, but then probably people will say that it was a war that was fought horribly for 5 years, but then America figured out how to fight it. And if that's the judgment, then it will be like the judgment, frankly, of a lot of wars, which we fought horribly for the first several
years. And meanwhile, this speech tonight is an interim speech, not a final speech. It's not going to resolve all the questions about the view.
Not in 15 minutes.
The old maxim, Jim, an army doesn't fight a war, a country fights a war. And if a country isn't willing to fight a war, it should never send an army. The United States was unwilling to fight this war. We did not in any way tax ourselves to pay for it. It's unpaid for. It's a cost looking now at $3 trillion estimated in ultimate cost for it. In disunity nationally, and the whole sense of American national collective sacrifice has been compromised.
Well, we'll see what the president says about it all. Okay. Thank you all.